Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Life and Adventures of Santa Claus by L. Frank Baum. Narrated by John McDonough. Youth. Chapter 1. Burzee. Have you heard of the great forest of Burzee? Nurse used to sing of it when I was a child. She sang of the big tree trunks standing close together, with their roots intertwining below the earth and their branches intertwining above it, of their rough coating of bark and queer gnarled limbs, of the bushy foliage that roofed the entire forest, save where the sunbeams found a path through which to touch the ground in little spots and to cast weird and curious shadows over the mosses, the lichens, and the drifts of dried leaves. The forest of Burzee is mighty and grand and awesome to those who steal beneath its shade. Coming from the sunlit meadows into its mazes, it seems at first gloomy, then pleasant, and afterward filled with never-ending delights. For hundreds of years it has flourished in all its magnificence, the silence of its enclosure unbroken save by the chirp of busy chipmunks, the growl of wild beasts, and the songs of birds. Yet Burzee has its inhabitants for all this. Nature peopled it in the beginning with fairies, nooks, ryls, and nymphs. As long as the forest stands, it will be a home, a refuge, and a playground to these sweet immortals who revel undisturbed in its depths. Civilization has never yet reached Burzee. Will it ever, I wonder? Chapter 2. The Child of the Forest. Once, so long ago, our great-grandfathers could scarcely have heard it mentioned, there lived within the great forest of Burzee a wood nymph named Nasil. She was closely related to the mighty Queen Zerline, and her home was beneath the shade of a wide-spreading oak. Once every year on budding day, when the trees put forth their new buds, Nasil held the golden chalice of Ok to the lips of the queen, who drank therefrom to the prosperity of the forest. So you see, she was a nymph of some importance, and moreover, it is said she was highly regarded because of her beauty and grace. When she was created, she could not have told, Queen Zerline could not have told, the great Ok himself could not have told. It was long ago when the world was new, and nymphs were needed to guard the forests and to minister to the wants of the young trees. Then, on some day not remembered, Nasil sprang into being, radiant, lovely, straight and slim as the sapling she was created to guard. Her hair was the color that lines a chestnut burr. Her eyes were blue in the sunlight and purple in the shade. Her cheeks bloomed with the faint pink that edges the clouds at sunset. Her lips were full red, pouting and sweet. For costume, she adopted oak leaf green. All the wood nymphs dress in that color, and know no other so desirable. Her dainty feet were sandal-clad, while her head remained bare of covering other than her silken tresses. Nasil's duties were few and simple. She kept hurtful weeds from growing beneath her trees and sapping the earth food required by her charges. she frightened away the gadgols, who took evil delight in flying against the tree trunks, and wounding them so that they drooped and died from the poisonous contact. In dry seasons, she carried water from the brooks and pools and moistened the roots of her thirsty dependents. That was in the beginning. The weeds had now learned to avoid the forests where wood nymphs dwelt. The loathsome gadgols no longer dared come nigh. The trees had become old and sturdy, and could bear the drought better than when fresh sprouted. So Nesil's duties were lessened, and time grew laggard, while succeeding years became more tiresome and uneventful than the nymph's joyous spirit loved. Truly, the forest dwellers did not lack amusement. Each full moon they danced in the royal circle of the queen. There were also the feast of nuts, the jubilee of autumn tintings, the solemn ceremony of leaf-shedding, and the revelry of budding day. But these periods of enjoyment were far apart and left many weary hours between. That a wood-nymph should grow discontented was not thought of by Nesil's sisters. It came upon her only after many years of brooding. But when once she had settled in her mind that life was irksome, she had no patience with her condition, and longed to do something of real interest, and to pass her days in ways hitherto undreamed of by forest nymphs. The law of the forest alone restrained her from going forth in search of adventure. While this mood lay heavy upon pretty Nesil, it chanced that the great Ark visited the forest of Burzee, and allowed the wood nymphs, as was their wont, to lie at his feet and listen to the words of wisdom that fell from his lips. Ark is the master woodsman of the world. He sees everything and knows more than the sons of men. That night he held the queen's hand, for he loved the nymphs as a father loves his children, and Nesil lay at his feet with many of her sisters, and earnestly hearkened as he spoke. "We live so happily, my fair ones, in our forest glades," said Ak, stroking his grizzled beard thoughtfully, "that we know nothing of the sorrow and misery that fall to the lot of those poor mortals who inhabit the open spaces of the earth. They are not of our race, it is true, yet compassion well befits beings so fairly favored as ourselves. Often as I pass by the dwelling of some suffering mortal, I am tempted to stop and banish the poor thing's misery. Yet suffering in moderation is the natural lot of mortals, and it is not our place to interfere with the laws of nature." "Nevertheless," said the fair queen, nodding her golden head at the master woodsman, "it would not be a vain guess that Ak has often assisted these hapless mortals." Ak smiled. "Sometimes," he replied, "when they are very young, children, the mortals call them, I have stopped to rescue them from misery. The men and women I dare not interfere with. They must bear the burdens nature has imposed upon them. But the helpless infants, the innocent children of men, have a right to be happy until they become full grown and able to bear the trials of humanity. So I feel I am justified in assisting them." Not long ago, a year maybe, I found 4 poor children huddled in a wooden hut, slowly freezing to death. Their parents had gone to a neighboring village for food and had left a fire to warm their little ones while they were absent. But a storm arose and drifted the snow in their path, so they were long on the road. Meantime the fire went out, and the frost crept into the bones of the waiting children. "Poor things," murmured the queen softly. "What did you do?" "I called Nelko, bidding him fetch wood from my forests and breathe upon it until the fire blazed again and warmed the little room where the children lay. Then they ceased shivering and fell asleep until their parents came." "I am glad you did thus," said the good queen, beaming upon the master. And Nesil, who had eagerly listened to every word, echoed in a whisper, "I, too, am glad."
"And this very night," continued Ok, "as I came to the edge of Burzee, I heard a feeble cry, which I judged came from a human infant. I looked about me and found, close to the forest, a helpless babe, lying quite naked upon the grasses and wailing piteously. Not far away, screened by the forest, crouched Shiegra, the lioness, intent upon devouring the infant for her evening meal."
"And what did you do, Ok?" asked the queen breathlessly.
"Not much, being in a hurry to greet my nymphs. But I commanded Shiegra to lie close to the babe and to give it her milk to quiet its hunger. And I told her to send word throughout the forest to all beasts and reptiles that the child should not be harmed."
"I am glad you did thus," said the good queen again, in a tone of relief. But this time Nesil did not echo her words, for the nymph, filled with a strange resolve, had suddenly stolen away from the group. Swiftly her lithe form darted through the forest paths, until she reached the edge of mighty Burzee, when she paused to gaze curiously about her. Never until now had she ventured so far, for the law of the forest had placed the nymphs in its inmost depths. Nesil knew she was breaking the law, but the thought did not give pause to her dainty feet. She had decided to see with her own eyes this infant Ok had told of, for she had never yet beheld a child of man. All the immortals are full grown. There are no children among them. Peering through the trees, Nesil saw the child lying in the grass. But now it was sweetly sleeping, having been comforted by the milk drawn from Shiegra. It was not old enough to know what peril means. If it did not feel hunger, it was content. Softly the nymph stole to the side of the babe and knelt upon the sward, her long robe of rose-leaf color spreading about her like a gossamer cloud. Her lovely countenance expressed curiosity and surprise, but most of all a tender womanly pity. The babe was newborn, chubby and pink. It was entirely helpless. While the nymph gazed, the infant opened its eyes, smiled upon her, and stretched out 2 dimpled arms. In another instant, Nesil had caught it to her breast and was hurrying with it through the forest paths. Chapter 3. The Adoption.
The master woodsman suddenly rose with knitted brows. "There is a strange presence in the forest," he declared. Then the queen and her nymphs turned and saw standing before them Nesil, with the sleeping infant clasped tightly in her arms, and a defiant look in her deep blue eyes. And thus for a moment they remained, the nymphs filled with surprise and consternation, but the brow of the master woodsman gradually clearing as he gazed intently upon the beautiful immortal who had wilfully broken the law. Then the great Ark, to the wonder of all, laid his hand softly on Nasil's flowing locks and kissed her on her fair forehead. "For the first time within my knowledge," said he gently, "a nymph has defied me and my laws. Yet in my heart can I find no word of chiding. What is your desire, Nesil?" "Let me keep the child," she answered, beginning to tremble and falling on her knees in supplication. "Here, in the forest of Burzee, where the human race has never yet penetrated?" questioned Ok. "Here, in the forest of Burzee," replied the nymph boldly. "It is my home, and I am weary for lack of occupation. Let me care for the babe. See how weak and helpless it is. Surely it cannot harm Burzee, nor the master woodsman of the world." "But the law, child!" "The law!" cried Ok sternly. "The law is made by the master woodsman," returned Nesil. "If he bids me care for the babe, he himself has saved from death who in all the world dare oppose me?" Queen Zerline, who had listened intently to this conversation, clapped her pretty hands gleefully at the nymph's answer. "You are fairly trapped, O Ok," she exclaimed, laughing. "Now, I pray you, give heed to Nesil's petition." The woodsman, as was his habit when in thought, stroked his grizzled beard slowly. Then he said, "She shall keep the babe, and I will give it my protection. But I warn you all that as this is the first time I have relaxed the law, so shall it be the last time. Nevermore, to the end of the world, shall a mortal be adopted by an immortal. Otherwise, would we abandon our happy existence for one of trouble and anxiety? Good night, my nymphs." Then Ok was gone from their midst, and Nesil hurried away to her bower to rejoice over her new-found treasure. Chapter 4. Claws. Another day found Nesil's bower the most popular place in the forest. The nymphs clustered around her and the child that lay asleep in her lap, with expressions of curiosity and delight. Nor were they wanting in praises for the great Ok's kindness in allowing Nesil to keep the babe and to care for it. Even the queen came to peer into the innocent childish face and to hold a helpless, chubby fist in her own fair hand. "What shall we call him, Nesil?" she asked, smiling. "He must have a name, you know." "Let him be called Claws," answered Nesil, "for that means a little one."
"Rather let him be called Necklaws," returned the queen, "for that will mean Nesil's little one." "Some people have called this name Necklaws, and others Nicholas, which is the reason that Santa Claus is still known in some lands as Saint Nicholas. But, of course, Necklaws is his right name, and Claus the nickname given him by his adopted mother, the fair nymph Nessile. The nymphs clapped their hands in delight, and Necklaws became the infant's name, although Nessile loved best to call him Claus, and in after days many of her sisters followed her example. Nessile gathered the softest moss in all the forest for Claus to lie upon, and she made his bed in her own bower. Of food the infant had no lack. The nymphs searched the forest for bell udders, which grow upon the goa tree, and when opened are found to be filled with sweet milk. And the soft-eyed does willingly gave a share of their milk to support the little stranger, while Shiegra, the lioness, often crept stealthily into Nessile's bower and purred softly as she lay beside the babe and fed it. So the little one flourished and grew big and sturdy day by day, while Nessile taught him to speak and to walk and to play. His thoughts and words were sweet and gentle, for the nymphs knew no evil, and their hearts were pure and loving. He became the pet of the forest, for Ok's decree had forbidden beast or reptile to molest him, and he walked fearlessly wherever his will guided him. Presently the news reached the other immortals that the nymphs of Burzee had adopted a human infant, and that the act had been sanctioned by the great Ok. Therefore many of them came to visit the little stranger, looking upon him with much interest. First the Ryles, who are first cousins to the wood nymphs, although so differently formed. For the Ryles are required to watch over the flowers and plants, as the nymphs watch over the forest trees. They search the wide world for the food required by the roots of the flowering plants, while the brilliant colors possessed by the full-blown flowers are due to the dyes placed in the soil by the Ryles, which are drawn through the little veins in the roots and the body of the plants as they reach maturity. The Ryles are a busy people, for their flowers bloom and fade continually, but they are merry and light-hearted, and are very popular with the other immortals. Next came the Nooks, whose duty it is to watch over the beasts of the world, both gentle and wild. The Nooks have a hard time of it, since many of the beasts are ungovernable and rebel against restraint. But they know how to manage them, after all, and you will find that certain laws of the Nooks are obeyed by even the most ferocious animals. Their anxieties make the Nooks look old and worn and crooked, and their natures are a bit rough from associating with wild creatures continually. Yet they are most useful to humanity and to the world in general, as their laws are the only laws the forest beasts recognize, except those of the master woodsman. Then there were the fairies, the guardians of mankind, who were much interested in the adoption of Claus, because their own laws forbade them to become familiar with their human charges. There are instances on record where the fairies have shown themselves to human beings and have even conversed with them, but they are supposed to guard the lives of men.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.